Hello, I'm Chris Flisher, and welcome to Turning of the Wheel, an intelligent, lively discussion on astrology, art, and adventure. Timing is everything, and as the great wheel turns, we are best prepared when we are best informed. Join me as I explore the current planetary alignments and offer insights for coping with change. Educational, informative, enlightening, the turning of the wheel is a welcome pause in your daily swirl of constant change. Through intelligent discourse, inspired guests, and educational segments, I will help to enlighten your knowledge of astrology and guide you to accept change as the great wheel of life turns. Call in with your questions and speak with some of the greatest visionaries in the time-tested practice of astrology. Turning of the Wheel, Astrology, Art, and Adventure with Chris Flisher, each week on Turning of the Wheel podcast.
Hello and welcome to Turning of the Wheel. My name is Chris Flisher. As you know, this is a show about astrology, and astrology takes in many different aspects of our lives. It touches every part of our lives. It touches our homes, our relationships, our communities, our jobs, our investments, and every sort of avenue you can possibly imagine. It has validity in all sectors of your life. And we're going to be discussing today financial aspects with my guest who's coming out in a few minutes, and we're going to try to do this. We're sort of experimenting this floating this idea out there as a sort of a regular feature to do every other month, perhaps something like that, to see, because you know you want to see how the astrology ties in with the way the markets are behaving and what you can best do to be proactive to maybe prevent some sort of a problem in the future. And when you have somebody who has as much knowledge as my guest has, you can go on that and place your bets in a much safer way, knowing that there's a logic behind the rationale of the investment or the trade that you're doing at that time. And before we get started and have him on, I want to remind you about my newsletter, which comes out every Sunday afternoon. I encourage you to sign up. You can get there from my website, turningofthewheel.com or chrisflisher.com. They should both go to the same spot. It's a drop down on there to sign up for the newsletter. And then boom, it shows up in your mailbox. And you see on there, you'll get my weekly videos. You'll get my weekly podcast. You'll get my weekly newsletter. And all you have to do is just sign up and boom, there it is. And away we go. And if you decide you want to help me out with that, that's also accepted as well. So without any further ado, we have Mitchell Scott Lewis on today. He's been a good guest in the past, a good friend of mine out of New York City. He spent a lot of time on the floor in the New York Stock Exchange, and he knows the financial markets very well. And astrology has been one of his saving graces because it's been allowed him to get insights into the markets based on historical cyclical trends that he's been able to establish and observe over the course of the last 30, 40, 50, 60 years, whatever. And so he's a great vessel of knowledge when it comes to the finances. And he uses the astrology as a means to help us guide our way through these troubled times, because we are certainly in troubled times. And if we're not seeing it now, we will see it soon. So welcome to the show, Mitch. It's always great to have you on.
Thank you, Chris. Always great to talk.
Yeah, so I mean, things right now, if you look at the sky, at the world right now, and you looked at all the government books and all the statistics that they dropped down, you'd think that the economy was doing great. But on the street, the average person may not be feeling quite that same buoyancy as what the markets predict. And of course, the markets are not an accurate prediction of what the economy is actually doing. It's more of
the stock market is only an indication of the stock market, frankly.
Right. And so even though the stock market might be doing great, that doesn't mean that the rest of the world's doing great. We don't know if they're cooking the books on the numbers of the job reports either, because I'm not sure what they classify as a job. It may be a $7.25 job at McDonald's, and they call that a job. But good luck trying to survive on that. So,
well, for one thing, Chris, it's a bit of a misconception that the stock market's doing great. It's a matter of opinion, of course. But I and quite a number of financiers out there, some who I know and some who are on CNBC and whatnot, we aren't in a bull market anymore. The full moon eclipse of, I think it was January 31st a year ago, not this past January 31st, that was the top in the Dow.
Yeah.
We have not made a new top since that. That's a year and 3 months. What we are doing is moving sideways. Yes, there are rallies, but they could very easily be what we call bear market rallies. They are, you know, and we have violent bear market rallies through the 70s and the early 80s. Yeah, we may have discussed this last time I was on your show.
Perhaps.
I did a whole series of lectures for a while, using, which I've got to edit and put on YouTube and whatnot, but using the markets, the charts of the New York Stock Exchange and and the Tao, and how from in 20-year segments I would take the markets apart and examine them. Because if you look at something from too big a position, as those of us with a lot of sage tend to do, you lose sight of the details.
Right.
But the last time that Saturn opposed Uranus was in 2008, and that led to the crash that I was able to predict a year and a half in advance, within a week of its occurrence. The time before that was 1965 to 67. Following that opposition, we were in a sideways market for 18 years. It took until 1982 before a new bull market started. But during that period of time, if you look at the charts, you will see violent, incredible swings in the markets where they will rally the equivalent today of thousands of points only to fail at the top again and again and again and again over a decade and a half.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when you pull back sufficiently and you look at that from that point of view, then you scratch your head. Now, can you make money? Well, if you're trading any market that's moving, I don't care if it's going up or down, you can make money from it. It's only markets that lay there like a latke that you can't make money from. But any market that is moving, you can trade if you are a trader. But if your money is in your retirement account and you're relying on these people to trade for you, many of whom only know how to buy stocks because this is how they make their money, you can go for a decade and not make any money at all in your retirement account.
Hmm. Well, most retirement accounts aren't most retirement accounts sort of in a divested fund, which has got a variety of different, you know, players in it. They usually
it depends on who's handling your investments.
Okay.
And even if it's a diverse, for example, a lot of accounts still hold gold.
Oh, I see.
To me, gold is an absolutely useless commodity. I have this argument with quote unquote financial astrologers all the time. Oh, gold's going to go to $10,000 an ounce. So that's ridiculous.
We're not on a gold standard anymore, right?
Of course not.
Yeah.
Of course not. And if they went on the gold standard today because of the trillions of dollars we've created, gold would have to be worth about $1 million an ounce. It's absolutely impossible. Our finances and our money and our currencies are based on essentially mutual trust, for lack of a better term.
Mm-hmm.
We believe that the dollar and the U.S. bonds and the euro and the Chinese currencies and all the rest are solid. Now, if they're not, and there's an underlying decay, well, you know, that's what happened in 2008.
Oh.
And starting in 2005, when Saturn, which rules the housing market, was traveling through Cancer. Now, Saturn rules the outside of the house, Capricorn, and Cancer, the opposite sign, was the inside of the house, the home, the furniture, the flowers, the decorations. That's how polarities work, the oppositions. While Saturn was traveling through Cancer, this housing market, this mortgage bubble was created or increased.
Mm-hmm.
And they were selling people, you know, people who make $30,000 a year, they were selling them $700,000 houses.
Right.
There's no way that they could possibly. It was all nonsense. And then they were bundling up these mortgages and selling them as real equities, which they weren't. Well, the month I was doing a lot of Jenny Lynch's TV shows, and I was doing some radio interviews, and of course I always had my newsletter. I predicted that would be the very top of the housing market. And the month that Saturn left Cancer, which I believe was July 2005, and then Saturn began its aspect to Neptune, that was the top of the housing market. And from there, it simply collapsed. And with the collapse of the housing market went the collapse of all the currencies.
Now, was it a Saturn-Neptune square or Saturn-Neptune opposition? Which was it? It was the...
I think it was an opposition. I think it might have been, but I honestly don't remember.
This was 2008?
So many of these lectures.
Yeah, no, I know.
No, 2005.
2005.
I'll look it up.
I'll look it up, too. I got it right here. Yeah,
it was an opposition. Saturn was in Leo, and Neptune was in Aquarius.
Yeah.
And that opposition, just like the Saturn-Uranus opposition of 2008, led from... It was like a 1-2 punch.
I see.
Look, Saturn doesn't rule trading. It rules banks, and it rules housing, and it rules the structure and the, obviously the stability of our entire foundation. It's Pluto that rules trade accounts, because Pluto is the eighth house. That's other people's resources or things that are held jointly together. Mm-hmm. When you put your retirement fund into a mutual fund and it's trading on the stock market, it's trading with a billion other people from around the world. That's an eighth house issue.
Right,
that's
right.
A Pluto issue. Mm-hmm. Now, because in 2020, we're going to have Saturn conjunct Pluto.
Right.
Well, now that brings up a lot of questions. Is that when the crash happens? Personally, I think that will begin the decay. In fact, we're already seeing the beginning of the decay. But it takes time. See, this is one of the problems that people have, whether you're an astrologer or you're not. Impatience. Well, right. You said that it was going to collapse. Yes, but I didn't tell you it was going to collapse tomorrow. I've been telling people for 6 months or longer, if you're over the age of 50, I would take my money out of the stock market, or a good deal of it. You want to still play a little bit, or you like to day trade or whatever, fine. Or you want to leave a little bit in certain stocks, fine. I believe in dividend-producing stocks. My family has had AT&T for two or three generations. My mother gets part of her income from it. I wouldn't touch that stock.
Yeah.
AT&T is not going out of business. But the stock fluctuates quite a bit. And as long as it pays the dividend, which it did even through the Great Recession, that's an income, and I don't have to worry about it, and that money comes in.
So what
but
do you...
There are a lot of...
Yeah, go ahead.
Go ahead.
What do you envision happening when we do see this decay? I mean, and what sort of magnitude do you see this happening?
Well, again, there are different kinds of decay.
Mm-hmm.
In 1965, 66, 67, we didn't see a stock market crash. And through the 70s, we didn't see a crash. What we saw is what I spoke of earlier. A lot of bear, we saw a bear market and huge bear market rallies. Now, the reason why these stocks rally is because they're manipulated. And people need to trade by law. If you have a hedge fund, you can't leave it idle. You have to trade it.
Okay.
You can decide how big and small your positions are, but you have to move that money. And so a lot of people were speculating. Or, look, there's a couple of stocks that I follow. One in particular. It's a very cheap stock. And it traded up to about $10, $12 at one point.
Mm-hmm.
Then it collapsed. It went as low as 68 cents.
Wow.
What happened there is that everybody ran in and started to buy it. They rallied it up to $3.50. And then they got out. And it crashed and went down to $1. And then it rallied up to $2.80. And it went down to 80 cents. And it ran up to $2.40, and it collapsed again, and it's back and forth and back and forth. You can trade that same stock over and over and over. And within its trading range, as long as it stays within that trading range, you can make a fortune. Let's say you buy 10,000 shares of it at $1. You're $10,000. Goes up to $2.20, you get out. You've more than doubled your money.
Yeah, no kidding.
Now you wait.
Right.
You wait. It goes back down to 80 cents. Now you can buy 20,000 shares. It runs up to $3, you've tripled your money. You get out and you wait. So there are a lot of different ways to trade.
Mm-hmm.
I mentioned to you before we got on the air, I just did an article for the NCGR. I don't remember which of their publications is coming out in, but it's got to do with the stock market. And I talk about how there are a lot of people, when I was on the floor of the Mercantile Exchange, I ran into other financial astrologers. Some of them were very smart. Some of them, I don't know. But it's not a new business. People have been using astrology, as you
know,
for a century or more, sure.
Easily.
Probably, you know, I always say that I think Joseph in the Bible was an astrologer because he interpreted the Pharaoh's dream of seven skinny calves eating up seven fatted calves. And he said there'll be 7 years of great growth followed by 7 years of famine.
Which is exactly a Saturn cycle.
There you go. That's exactly what it is. And the Pharaoh believed him, and as a result, he put away a lot of grain and stuff in the storage houses, and sure enough, the crash, so to speak, happened, and everybody moved to Egypt because it was the only place that had any food.
Yeah.
That's how the Israelis wound up in Egypt and became the slaves of a Passover. See, it's all historical, but it's also astrological, and it's all fundamental. It's not by accident that Nazi Germany rose to its prominence. It was because of the end of the First World War, the Great Depression, and the fact that Germany had to pay restitution from the First World War threw them into a terrible financial bind. And then, of course, whoever could convince the people that they had an answer for them, same thing is happening in Venezuela. Same
right.
thing that happens all over the country, all over the world. Turkey is hanging on by a thread. Turkey had many good years economically. I don't even want to get into the politics of it or anything, but just economically, and now that's not happening anymore.
And that reason is because, what points to that reason?
Well, it has to do with cycles.
If they're 7 years, are they in a 7-year cycle themselves?
Well, yeah, there are some are easy to follow. But Chris, you know that sometimes astrology isn't that simple. If it was, we'd all be rich and brilliant and own houses. And no, astrology is very complicated, and it's a matter of interpretation. Now, one of the points that I made in the article for the NCGR is that you can know all the astrology in the world, and you can be very, very smart and very clever. But if you don't know how to trade a market, you are talking from ignorance.
Yeah,
stupidity.
Yeah,
ignorance.
Yeah.
Yeah, if you don't know how to do something, look, I have a friend who's very good with computers. That's not my forte. And I'll call him up and I'll say to him, I can't do this. And he I'm a musician. And he said, among other things, and he says to me, why can't you do that? It's so simple. And I always say to him, why can't you play Bach?
Good answer. Yeah.
We all have our skills and
yes.
we all have our knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't go out of my way and plan to go down to Wall Street. I needed a job, making a living as an astrologer or a musician.
You're not going to fare too well. You're exactly right.
Right. So I went down to Wall Street with a couple of my clients, dragged me down there kicking and screaming. And I got there and the Sagittarius side of me, all the Jupiter and everything went, oh, my God, this is just a giant casino. I like this. This will be fun.
Giant
but
casino. That's exactly what it is.
Yeah, of course it is.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't get these guys to play poker or do anything else. They'd say to me, we'll go to Atlantic City. They'd say to me, why bother? We're in a casino that never closes. We can trade all night long.
Yeah.
So, but in order to make it work, I studied copious amounts. Oh, my God, the amount of work that I did with some of my trading partners, where I would have the ephemeris in my lap. And one of my partners would have, let's say, 20 years of cotton or soybeans or whatever we were studying.
Yep, yep, yep.
And through the ephemeris, I would tell him when the tops and the bottoms of the markets were. And it blew him out. He couldn't believe it. That's when we started to raise some real money to try and make this work. And some of the calls were remarkable. But more to the point, on a day-to-day basis, I was able to make a living. There were some times when I had big accounts, and there were other times after a mini crash, when all of my investors needed their money to cover their stocks, they pulled the money out of our accounts. I had to trade one or two lots back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. I was still able to pay all my bills and to make a living.
Wow.
And so, and only through astrology. I mean, but again, not only through astrology.
Well, knowing the market.
Astrology
yeah,
is my name, but knowing the markets.
Right.
And understanding support and resistance. And understanding all different kinds. The GAN wheel, Fibonacci numbers, candlesticks. How to use options, how to create certain. So all of this takes time. And it really would behoove anybody who wants to do this and thinks that they can make a living at it, whether they're using astrology or not, take some courses.
Yeah.
Learn a little something.
Mm-hmm.
Learn from people who've been doing this for 20 or 30 years. And then you have a much better shot if you sit there with your E-Trade account or TD Ameritrade or whatever it is. And you sit there and you wait. When I think the market is going to take a big tumble, I look at the options. I buy puts on the S&P. I don't sell options. Selling options, just for those of you who don't know, selling an option has a limitless risk. If it goes against you and you don't get out in time, you can literally lose a fortune.
I see.
But buying an option, you can only lose what you pay for the option.
Mm-hmm.
So if you spend $1,000 and you buy an option, it goes against you, the worst that can happen is you lose the $1,000. The most accounts, unless you're very wealthy, or you have the money to back it, will not allow you to sell options. So you can only buy them. I only buy options. I would never sell them. I wouldn't take that kind of a risk.
Yeah.
And so I would buy a put in the S&P, but I have to know what that means. Puts expire. They decay in time. Well, how much time have I got? And when do I think the crash is going to happen? That's when the astrology and the knowledge of the stock market go hand
that's
in hand.
That's when it kicks in. So yeah. What do you see on the future coming up? I mean, we talked about this before in the past, and you've always mentioned that there's usually a Saturn Neptune connection somewhere along the line. And in the case that you mentioned,
not necessarily Saturn Neptune. Saturn and any outer planet will create a certain amount of hesitation or unsuredness in
exactly.
The market.
Yeah, because there's a certain stoicism to it. You got to be careful with it. Yeah, I understand that. But when we look at the years coming up, I mean, we're going to have this Jupiter Saturn Pluto conjunction and coming up, and of course that is to me bodes a really large correction of some sort. And the fact that it's in the United States' second house, that would definitely bode for a huge financial reorganization. But what does a reorganization look like? Would it be the same as the Depression? Would it be, I mean, what are the actual mechanics of what happens at a time like that? Do people can't get their money?
Well, first of all, I refuse to be a doomsday prophet.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see any point to it.
No, I don't
either. If I'm wrong, I look like an idiot. And if I'm right, there's nobody there to pay me.
Right.
So what in 2000, for example, leading up to 2008, we were in an election year, as you know. Among other things, I saw that because of the Saturn-Uranus opposition, that we were going to change our society radically. What that meant to me was, in the election, either a woman or a black man was going to be elected, Hillary or Obama.
Mm-hmm.
There was no way the Republicans were going to win that election, and it proved right. Now, but that, of course, that's Uranus wanting radical change.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yep.
It was several years after the Saturn-Neptune had dissipated already. What the Saturn-Neptune did was it dissolved the bottom of the housing market. That, in turn, became one of the dominoes that fell that created the Great Crash and the Great Recession. That recession easily could have turned into the second Great Depression in American history.
Had they not acted quickly on the TARP, right?
Well, had Obama not hired the people that he hired,
right.
Frankly.
Mm-hmm.
You know, now hindsight, everybody, 2020 hindsight, and the rest of this, I don't know what would have happened had the Republicans won the election, how they would have handled it, but based on what they were saying at the time, I don't think they would have stepped in and done what was necessary to have done. And so I think we actually would have been in a depression. And this is not a Republican versus Democrat
discussion. No, I understand that. No, this is just simply purely objective. I get that. Yeah.
Yeah. Now, so as we head into go ahead.
What does that look like? I mean, what does that look like? What does a depression look like in the year 2000s? I mean, do people is massive 25% unemployment? People living and eating out of soup kitchens? Is that what we see? We see people's houses being foreclosed.
Well, in 2008. And 2009 and 2010. You know, I may have said this before in one of your other shows, but people pay our government. I'm sorry, our government pays people to buy their bonds. When we were kids, you bought a bond for $18.75, and a certain number of years later, you could sell it for $25. It was a $25 bond that you paid $18.75.
Yeah, I used to think, I got some from my baptism, I think.
Okay, right. So the government is basically borrowing money from you and me and everybody else to run the country.
Right.
So they pay you a dividend for doing that. In 2008 and 2009, it was the only time in American history that people paid our government to buy our bonds. There was no place in the world that they felt their money was safe. Iceland, Ireland, Italy, Spain, Portugal, they almost went out of business because they were so vested in the nonsense of the American mortgage companies, that they literally almost folded. Iceland essentially did go out of business. They went completely bankrupt. So people didn't know what to do. There was still a lot of money on the books. Where do we put our money? Where is it safe? Well, They were paying us, I think, a tenth of a percent to buy our box. Never heard of it before. So, you know, we didn't fall apart. We didn't go into that depression. But if the policies of any administration are such, and the Feds, you know, the Federal Reserve and the banking authorities decided to ignore the warning signs, which has happened in the past, that's essentially what led to the Depression of 1930s, was that pre-FDR, Hoover did nothing to shore up the markets. He didn't believe it was going to be a crash. He refused to believe it. He was very pro-business. He didn't care about the individuals. And so, boom.
That's an 84-year cycle, which brings us back to the ingress of Uranus into Taurus.
Uranus into Taurus, of
right.
course.
So,
of course.
I mean, so the
but remember,
the markers
in,
are there.
In the last time Uranus traveled to Taurus was the beginning of the New Deal.
Yes.
Social Security, unemployment benefits, banking,
radical new way of
so on,
radical
so
way of going, exactly. But we seem to be going the other right. direction. That's what concerns me.
Well, that's, you know, just because, hey, we learned into our lives that just because the last time Saturn squared Venus, it meant this, doesn't mean that's what it's going to mean this time.
No, of course not.
You need to be prepared. Of course, you look back and you say, and I've had, of course, many clients have come to me with their personal issues, and they know a lot about astrology. They say to me, oh, Saturn's going to cross my ascendant, and the last time, 28 years ago, blah, blah, blah happened. Well, I look at the rest of the occurring transits,
right.
progressions,
exactly.
solar arc directions,
mm-hmm.
and I say, well, I don't think that's what's going to happen this time.
Right.
I think it's going to be this, and this, and this. Well, the same thing is true when we look at the cycles of the world.
Right. I've always used the idea of time being a corkscrew, whereby we have a theme is returned, a theme returns, a theme is cyclical, but it's down the road within a different context every time.
Right. Absolutely. Right. Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
And so we are in a different context now. Now, then the question becomes, well, 2020 is an election year.
Yep.
What happens? If this current administration maintains power, frankly, and again, I don't mean this politically, I mean this more...
This is an observation. This is an observation, yeah.
The ideas and the concepts that are being pushed out now are the antithesis of what the markets want.
Right, we're racking up debt. We're racking up debt like crazy. Our deficit.
Well, we're racking up debt, but we are also, one of the things that Wall Street hates, that all these markets hate, is unsureness,
right.
insecurity.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't like the Republican perspective or the Democratic perspective, but it looks like the people who are running it know what they're doing, well, maybe you don't like it personally, maybe you don't talk about it with your in-laws. But if they are doing things that are creating an insecurity, a deep-rooted insecurity, and of course that's what's happening. And it goes right back to the essentially, in my opinion, $1.5 trillion theft that took place over a year ago,
right.
with that tax cut.
Yep.
That was the biggest theft in human history. It is doing nothing to help middle class, working class, or anybody else. It is only, and of course we all knew that when these corporations got all this money back, they weren't going to give it to their workers.
That's the fallacy of trickle-down. That trickle-down has never worked.
Absolutely. What they did was they took the money and they bought back all their stocks so that their stock, the people who held their stocks made a lot of money. And everybody else can go do you know what with themselves.
Right.
So, you know, if that's going to continue for another 4 years, well, then I'll tell you the truth. I don't have much hope. I really don't.
Well, I understand that. And I think we've been talking about this for quite some time. We can see sort of the handwriting on the wall with what's coming up. But if that does happen in that period of time, then we know where the fault is going to lie. Because everybody wants to own, they want to own the success, but they've got to own the bottom, too. You can't have it both ways.
Right, right. Well, the problem is that some politicians, no names to be mentioned, only care about right now.
Yeah.
It's the same thing, but see, that's the same problem with the people who are handling your retirement fund. They want you to open up your envelope at the end of the quarter or the end of the year and say, oh my God, they made me 7.5%. I'm going to stick with them.
Yeah.
So what they do is at the end of each of the quarters, what they call the triple witching periods when all of these funds and things come due is they go on a buying spree, and they push the markets up, and then the markets look terrific in your envelope, and then very often a month later, if you go and you look again, you go, what happened to all that money I had? Because it's not real.
Right. It's
manipulated, and it's you know, they're just pushing numbers around.
Wow.
Well, that's okay on the short term. But when you're dealing with the long term, and you take $1.5 trillion off the table, and you give it to huge corporations, and you know, and you don't put it into infrastructure, and you don't put it into housing for working class and middle class people, and you don't give them a tax break. I mean, my God, they made the tax cuts for corporations and for the top 1% permanent.
I know, and ours are only good for a year.
Right, well, a couple of years.
And the thing is that, you know, then, anybody who knows anything knows that if you don't keep the mass populace employed and flush with money, nothing is going to work, because all of a sudden the restaurants start closing, the movie theaters close, the people don't buy cars and TVs anymore. That's where that is the engine that churns this economy, is the middle class. And to remove that money from us is exactly the most stupidest thing in the world. I swear to God. Anyway,
well, but again, this has been an argument essentially between Republicans and Democrats for a century.
Yeah, it goes back. I remember Reagan talking about trickle-down as well, so this is not a new topic. Okay. We're going to take a break right now. We're talking today with Mitch Scott Lewis. His website is jupiterrising.com or mitchastro.com. He is an astrologer out of New York City who does a lot of work with financial predictions as well as medical. So those are very good things, as well as being an excellent astrologer on top of it all. But I encourage you to go there and sign up for his newsletter, touch base with him, get a reading with him or whatever, because the information that you can get here might actually save you down the road. We're going to take a quick break. I will be back in about 2.5 minutes. Check out jupiterrising.com and mitchastro.com and see what you can learn. And he's also a published author as well. So, there's a lot to behold there. So I encourage you to swing by there on the break and see what's going on. And we'll be back in about 2.5 minutes.
What is your destiny? Where are you going? What is your real purpose? Do you know? Do you want to know? Of course you do. It's your duty to yourself. We are all here for a reason, and we all have great potential. Discover all of this and more with a professional astrology reading. My name is Chris Flisher, and I can help you. Discover your strengths and work on your weaknesses, and live your life to its fullest capacity. Based on your birthday, birthplace, and birth time, an authentic astrology reading will allow you to live your life to the fullest and reveal your true purpose. Only real astrology can give you real information. It is your destiny, and it is your path. Write me at chris@chrisflisher.com and book a reading today. Or call me at 978-393-1036. That's 978-393-1036. www.chrisflisher.com.
Astrology is the science of spirit, and it can serve as an invaluable aid in making the difficult choices in life and seeking truth in all the directions we choose. It holds the potential to allow each of us to evolve to our highest potential. It is the logic of the universe, the code of existence, and the pathway to true wisdom. It is our duty to draw from it the instructions for our lives and to live them to our fullest potential. As the great wheel turns, we are best prepared when we are best informed.
As the world shrinks and our barriers come down, diverse cultures are striving for harmony, balance, and peace. To ease the transition, we need to expand with color, light, and tolerance. Now, you can become a global citizen and embrace the color and clear spirit with the divine artwork of the mandala. Mandalas are a timeless artistic offering for creating unity, harmony, and peace. My name is Chris Flisher, and I've spent years creating mandalas, and they are now available online at www.turningofthewheel.com. Come and experience the world of color, form, and function with t-shirts, coffee mugs, note cards, and limited edition prints. These vibrant, lively paintings and products express optimism, oneness, and spiritual balance for all who use them. www.turningofthewheel.com. That's www.turningofthewheel.com. and enter a world of possibility and color.
Okay, welcome back to Turning the Wheel. My guest today is Mitchell Scott Lewis. He's an astrologer of New York City who's known for his work with financial markets as well as his work with medical astrology, two of things which are both near and dear to all of us, health and money. And his website's jupiterrising.com or mitchastro.com. He also publishes a monthly newsletter which is full of interesting ideas and great information about how things are happening, not only with the markets, but with, you know, astrology in general and all of us, because much of what happens with astrology does happen to us all on a global level. It's called mundane astrology. I always write up a couple of paragraphs about it each week as well. So it's important to add that. But anyway, Mitch, we were talking about the crash and what that would look like. Now, you know, we've been talking about the Pluto return in the United States, something that no individual human can ever encounter because it's a 248-year some odd cycle like that. But and so the United States as an entity is going to be experiencing this now. Now, we all know, all astrologers all know, that Pluto is the great deliverer of reckoning of some sort, or sort of got a karmic debt to it, whereby it's time to sort of pay the piper. And when this is actually falling into this current, the transit we're talking about is falling into the second house of the United States, does that mean, or do you think it means, I should say, you can't state it equivocally, do you think it means a sort of a complete restructuring of the United States financial markets as well as sort of our whole political spectrum? We sort of see the inklings of that already with what's been happening over the last several years. I'm just curious, what do you think about that? What would that actually look like? I mean, if we owe all this money to China, how does China get that money back? Do they convey us and say, we want our money back? What does it look like, do you think?
Well, first of all, it's the Chinese that are investing in us. It's not the other way around.
Oh, yeah. I know. We're borrowing Chinese money from them, right?
The Chinese hold more of our debt than anybody else. If they suddenly decided, hey, you really want to play a trade war with us? Okay. We don't want your bonds anymore. We're not gonna lend you any money.
I know. And that's exactly what they're doing. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly.
So now, remember, the second house, Taurus, isn't just money, it's values. And Pluto brings...
resources. Yeah.
Yeah, but Pluto brings infections and hidden agendas to the surface. When you go through a heavy Pluto aspect, if there's anything wrong in your body, remember, astrology doesn't make you sick, just right. To bring in the medical side for a minute. It simply opens up the window of opportunity. Mm-hmm. If you've been sitting and eating like a fool for the last 20 years and you go through a major aspect, well, you might have a problem. But if you really take care of yourself and you have go through a major aspect, well, you might have a minor issue, but chances are good it's not going to make you sick. But we have an infection in our society. You can call it many things. You can call it racism, anti-Semitism.
Isolationism, yeah. Nationalism, right. Yeah. They've got a lot of isms.
And it constantly comes back to haunt us because of the nature of America's natal chart. And we are always dealing with the values, what's more important. Remember, again, with Taurus, with Uranus transiting through Taurus in the 1930s, FDR absolutely radicalized our society. To this day, there are people who were raised in Roosevelt-hating Republican homes. They have never, the man's been dead for half a century, and they are still more, and they are still, they hate what Roosevelt did, and they think that he created socialism, and they don't recognize that this was the foundation upon which we built this tremendous society with these big cities and all of this. And every time there is decay in this society, and the infrastructure is a perfect way to look at it, the whole damn thing is falling apart.
Yeah.
Bridges and tunnels, the subway system in New York City, my God, it's horrible. Mm-hmm. This is considered one of the great cities in the world, and God help you, you get stuck on a subway down there.
And I know, I've been there.
Yeah, well, but it also, how would you like to be on a bridge in the Midwest that collapses? How would you like to be in one of these cities that was built either on steel or on coal or on the car industry?
Yeah, exactly.
And the cities are being the people are running out of them. like rats from a sinking ship.
Or if you're a city built on reclaimed land, you know, reclaimed land, like in Boston, for example, then as global change happens, climate change happens, and the waters begin to rise, that land is nowhere near as solid as it used to be.
Of course. Well, New York is nothing but a bunch of islands.
Yeah.
De Blasio is trying to put through a multi-billion dollar fund, which he's going to need federal help doing, to build a flood wall, essentially, around lower Manhattan. Otherwise, Wall Street is going to go one day, and that'll be the end of it.
Yeah, which would be kind of
interesting.
Miami
Beach. I love Miami Beach. I hate the people and I hate the guns, but I love the weather. And on Lincoln Road in the middle of Miami Beach, which is one of the real premier pieces of real estate, we've got these wonderful stores and wonderful restaurants. It's just a charming place to go. Now, on a full moon or a high tide, there's a foot or two of water.
Well, you're kidding me. I didn't know that. Wow. Wow.
Yeah, there never was before. And people say to me, and Miami is in one of the huge building booms in America. Miami, Austin, Texas. I was out there. Well, I was out in Austin, Texas in, I forget when it was, for a couple of my clients wanted me out there. And so I went out, and I'd never been there, and I have some dear friends who live there. I was so happy to visit them. You couldn't drink the water. There was a problem. They get all of their water from the river, and the river had turned brown, and you could not drink the water. And if you bathed, if you took a shower, you had to keep your eyes and your mouth closed. The whole time I was there, and the hotel was handing out as much free bottled water as you wanted. I didn't have a hot cup of coffee the whole time I was there. They couldn't brew it.
Oh, my gosh. You're kidding me.
No.
That was the water problem, that they had that water problem.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The whole city. So, you know, so these are the issues. And, of course, climate change. I mean, good God. I mean, there are a couple of astrologers out there. I never mention names. It's not my goal but a couple of astrologers out there who are vehement climate change deniers. They believe in every conspiracy theory that comes along. And I find it very, very difficult I will not work with them. I will not deal with them. I simply don't want to be annoyed. I'm not going to waste the time that I have left fighting over things that are so blatantly obvious and so dangerous. And especially in a business like ours, where people come to us day after day, what can I do? I'm scared. I have all kinds of problems.
But there is a lot of fear. There's a lot of fear in the world. That's one thing that seems to be has definitely gone up on the radar screen. I mean, you see it all over Facebook. People are afraid, and with good reason. We can see stuff happening that does disturb us, and it seems as if there's been a massive sea level change here. And I don't mean to go back to, I mean, no pun intended, a bit to the water rising, but there's been a sea change here that has to do with how our values are being put out. And so we're kind of at a crossroads where we have to say, Do we return back to our values which first set this country free to begin with, or do we fall victim to the values that have been imposed on us now? I always think of any return, whether it be a return or a retrograde, I think of we use the RE as an opportunity to sort of reconsider things, rethink things. So now the Pluto return comes back and allows us to review our values. I think values is a very good term to use in that respect, because it really is about an
age.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I don't consider the Pluto return evil. I don't consider Saturn an evil planet.
Oh, no.
That's why I love Liz Green's skinny little book, Saturn, A New Look at an Old Devil. I always loved that. I haven't read it in a while, but I remember it having a great influence on me and changing my whole attitude towards astrology.
Yeah. I think of Saturn as a friend. I mean, it's the one that gets you to move things, to do things, to get it done, to save yourself eventually.
Absolutely. There's an analogy I always use, Chris, because, you know, I write these novels.
Yeah.
On a Jupiter transit, 10 people come to me and they've read the novel and they all going to make it into a movie and I'm fighting over which one. And when Jupiter leaves, I'm left with the book in my hands.
Right.
Saturn comes along, one guy with a big fat belly, smoking a huge cigar, puffs it in my face and says to me, "Listen to me, I'm going to make it a movie, but you have to rewrite this and you're going to work your ass off." And I do it, and at the end of it, I have a movie.
That's the difference. Yeah, I mean, that's the work you've got to do. That's nothing worth having ever comes easily. We know that. That's just a natural.
Now, one more point I want to make. We talk about what you said before about the values and reestablishing them and revisiting them. Remember, our society, as much as we like to think of the founding fathers as being enlightened people, and they certainly were, and they were brilliant, this whole group of people, they were like the 1927 Yankees, for God's sakes, most brilliant people that ever lived. But they were slave owners, they were racists, they were anti-Semites, they had all kinds of problems. Women had very few rights. So we've developed a society, and we've grown, we like to believe. Look at this Congress. There's so many diverse people in this Congress, so many women I'm so pleased to see taking a leadership role. They certainly can't do any worse than the men have done the last couple of centuries. And what Pluto is going to do, I believe, is bring all of this up to the surface. And what this administration and what's happening, you know, in the world, again, not to blame any one individual, but what's happening with these hatred and crimes and the murders, the mass murders, is horrible. That's an infection. That has to be brought to the surface. And eventually, we have got to make a change. The children who stood up first gun rights and now for global change, for climate change.
It's amazing. It's just amazing.
Of course. Yeah. Well, but you see, that's a funny way to put it. We are handing it to them. It's their world.
It's their world, of course, yeah. And so they have a... But the fact that they're coming into it so young and so inspired by it, it gives me great hope that they're ready to do that. You know, I love that.
Let's hope. Mm. It's all for the children. Everything is for the children.
Yeah, of course.
I wrote a song a number of years ago, and in the chorus is a line, just like love and Christmas Day, the future is mostly for the children anyway. Please make them proud of the world that they found.
Yeah.
So this is exactly where we are at. This is why I have hope that this Pluto return will not be pretty. God knows what we've been going through the last couple of years has gotten worse and worse. There was another mass shooting, I think, in Denmark.
Amsterdam, yeah. Three people were killed in the subway. Yeah, I saw that, yeah.
Right. And this is just all over the world now.
But this, I think a lot of this stuff is happening. It's sort of a crescendo, of a building to a crescendo moment where things do say enough is enough and we change for the better. That's my my optimistic view.
That's right.
Perhaps naive.
Well, you know, I had a conversation with one of my astrology friends a few years ago. I said, if you could go back in time and kill Hitler, would you? And she said, well, I don't know. We don't know what the world would be like if we hadn't gone through Hitler.
Right. It's just like the same.
Very well taken.
Yeah, it's the same thing. It's the same sort of logic that I actually apply to the current administration. Had things gone the way, had Hillary perhaps won, maybe we wouldn't have been faced with this situation where we had to reclaim our values, restate our values. So this is sort of a catalytic moment, despite how much we may not like it or do like it. The catalytic moment is what gets us off our asses to move and gets the things back to straightened out. And that's just the only way.
Absolutely.
That's the logic I think.
Absolutely.
Of it. Yeah.
Absolutely. And when we're talking about now, you know, is a progressive Democrat going to win the White House?
Probably not
a radical one.
No.
No. It's going to be somebody who's more middle of the road. I'm putting on Facebook an interpretation of Beto's chart, which I've been working on the last couple of days. I'll have it ready, I hope, today or early tomorrow.
Yeah.
And I'll pop it up there.
Well, he's an interesting character. He announced very early. He announced during a Mercury retrograde, which I think is kind of crazy. But he could be somebody...
during a Mercury retrograde. But look, Joe Biden is waiting until the day after Mercury goes direct to announce. Isn't that something? You don't think that he has a few friends that say, Joe, maybe you don't believe in astrology, but why would you screw with the fates?
Well, I mean, that's a good sign. If he's paused, he's not waiting until the shadow period, though. He's just waiting until after the day, until it goes direct.
Well, no, you know... Listen, well, you're going to go through the whole, you know,
it'll be April 16th.
Shadow phase.
Yeah, I know.
The whole,
I know,
back.
I know,
give
I know.
Me a break. Come
yeah.
on. You know, most astrologers don't even bother with that. Right. But certainly, and you know, Beto has a Sun Pluto conjunct, yeah. And we're going through our Pluto return. And you know, he announced the other day that he was, I forget how he put it, he was meant to do this. Well, that's an outer planet to a personal planet.
Yep.
Speaking.
Yeah,
that's you know, it's Trump with his son Uranus.
He feels like he's been tapped.
I knew 30 years ago I was going to be president of the United States. Okay.
Yeah.
So that doesn't mean that they don't necessarily win, but it does show the. And remember that Pluto people do tend to be stubborn, unbending, unyielding, a little arrogant, controlling. So who knows?
And there is a strain of evil there as well. So that's, I understand that. But you know, a dark side of evil. But you think about the idea of where we would go here. This would be, if we were to bring in a older person who has been in this position or close to this position before, and we use him as a reset. I guess the larger question I would ask is, have we learned enough in these last 2 or 3 years to make that decision, or do we really need to be pounded into the ground through an 8-year term in order to right that ship, in order to correct that boat?
Well, also the question is, has that individual learned in the last decade or so?
Of course not.
do you think that Joe Biden has learned from his mistakes? You think that he's been pointed out, well, Joe, you know, we like a lot of what you say, but look at what you did with there's a number of things. I don't want to go through the litany of his whole...
No, but he's had some bad moments, there's no question. I mean, Anita Hill is one of them.
Of course, and they're going to come back to haunt him.
Yeah.
But, I mean, look, Chris, again, I try to keep my politics out of astrology. I don't always succeed. I've paid a very big price for my political position. I am essentially persona non grata on a very big radio show these days, and that's because of my politics.
Right.
And the show has become extremely right-wing and Trumpite. And
here's what I think is important that we state before we talk about politics, because politics inevitably enter into our conversation because we're living the astrology of the moment so clearly that it's hard not to equate the two. I think the most important view of point to make here is that we are using astrology to look at this through the lens of objectivity, not through political bias. That's how I approach it. I may have my opinions. I try to keep those sequestered and down, but I think that the logic of the astrology that we're seeing certainly dovetails perfectly with where we are right now. That's why you can't help but make an observation that doesn't involve politics. We're going through a time of enormous reorganization, reshuffling, unprecedented kinds of actions are taking place, all of which begs the question, which is why they need to almost rewrite the Constitution now, because this guy is doing things wasn't in the Constitution. Well, they're going to have to rewrite it so that it is in the Constitution so somebody else doesn't get in the same position down the road further.
I read in the New York Times today, or maybe it was Sunday's Times, I don't remember, that there have been over 11,000 amendments to the Constitution that have been put up. And
Since when?
I don't remember this. There are, since the beginning.
Since the beginning?
And there have been about 17 that have actually taken. Oh, however many amendments we have, I don't even remember offhand.
No, so there's only 17?
It is a document, while it is built to change. That's why there are amendments allowed in it. It is very, very hard to make a change in the Constitution. Very hard. It takes a generation or more to push an idea like that. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. Look, remember, America is a Sun-Saturn square nation.
Right.
We are a conservative nation with the Moon in Aquarius and the Sagittarius ascendant. So we are progressive and conservative at the same time.
Yeah,
we're visionary. What people forget, what astrologers forget, is America has Mars square Neptune. We have a lot of fear.
Yeah.
We are a very, very fearful nation in ways that, I was in the World Trade Center the day before 9/11, and I was supposed to go back that day, and I never heard from my friend in the cotton pit, and so I didn't bother getting up, and they blew up the World Trade Center, along with my whole world and my business and my friends and everything else. But before anybody even knew what had happened, who had done it, anything else, they passed these draconian laws giving the government and the president more and more power. Pearl Harbor, a horrible, horrible thing, drew us into the Second World War. FDR, one of the most progressive presidents we ever had, threw not only Japanese, but anybody who looked Asian into the tournament.
I remember. Mm-hmm.
So, that's the fear. That's the Mars-Neptune square. If you have a Mars-Neptune square in your natal chart, now you can certainly work through any aspect, as you well know. If we didn't believe that, why bother studying astrology?
Right.
A psychic who tells you you're going to meet a beautiful girl on the subway, so you run to the subway every day. We believe in free will astrology. And what that free will allows us is to to learn from the transits, to study our charts, or if you're not an astrologer, to go to an astrologer or a therapist or anybody else and learn how to take the weaknesses within you and turn them into your greatest strengths.
Right. That's what it's all about, taking your liabilities and making them assets. And that's the challenge of the chart. That's the purpose of life in many ways. We all have squares. We all have oppositions in our charts. And those are moments where they're moments of learning, moments of pushing through the baggage that you've carried with you all your life. It's a way to evolve and become a better human being. It's to become your true self. And it has to be a continual thing, just like time is. Time is always marching forward. So are we. So as we grow forward, we have to gain more momentum and experience and education and live to our great potential.
This reminds me of my late sister-in-law bought me a book of astrology. You know, jokes, comics.
Yeah.
And I remember one of them, you see this girl lying on the bed going, "Oh, woe is me. Why is my life so horrible?" And then Sally discovers astrology. And you see the next little, you know, image of her lying on the bed going, "Oh, woe is me. Why was I born with Neptune near my ascendant?"
That is funny.
Very funny. I wish I could find the book. Yeah. I may be here in my library somewhere. But it, you know, that's exactly the point. And, you know, I have people who come to me, a lot of astrologers, and they want, you know, "Well, what do you see about this?" They say to me, "Oh, I know I'm going through these horrible aspects and my life is going to be horrible." And what'd you come to me for?
Right. Well, they want guidance. They want guidance. They want guidance.
Yeah, and some, you know what some of them want? They go from one reader to another till they hear what they want to hear.
Oh, I know that. That's true. Yeah, they just keep going until they hear what they want to hear. But, you know, exactly. I think that this is, you know, understanding astrology and accepting it for what it's a moment of honesty. It's a moment of truth. You've got to sit down and look at the chart and say, this is what is, and I can't get out of it. You're born with it. This is what you got. And you either work with it and work yourself up and out of it using what challenges that are there to better your life, or you'll be forever doomed. I had a client who said, "I don't like my chart. I don't believe that that's who I am." I said, "Listen, I can't help it. This is who you are. This is who you are, and you're not going to be able to change it."
I love that. You know, how do I change my chart? Well, I can do a planetectomy, but it's going to cost you a lot of money.
Yeah, it just doesn't work that way. I'm not even sure that would work. But the thing is that you can't change who you are, but you can shift the way you approach that person. You can change your attitude toward your relationship to who you think you are. You can change that. And that can be brought about by personal self-discovery. Oftentimes people go through severe tragedies that make them come to terms with their lives in different ways because they've been awoken in some ways. But these are things that happen as a regular part of it. And the better you know your astrology chart, you'll realize that these are your challenges and these are things you've got to rise above. And when you step into them, rewarded.
That's essentially what we're talking about for America.
Yes. Exactly.
America had to go through whatever you want to say. Let's call it, you know, this administration or the struggle or the terrible rift in our society.
Yeah.
In order for us to finally say, what the hell?
This is what I'm saying. This is a moment of awakening for us. We are seeing
absolutely
we have to awaken to. And with the fact we've got this such disparity there, you know, I'm not even sure why Americans are so fearful. I mean, we have, you know, think about it geographically from a standpoint of old term military terms. We've got oceans east and west. We've got allies north and south. At least we used to. So what could be better as far as protection? I mean, nobody, you know, people aren't. It's absurd. We are a very safe country. We've gone a little bit too far as putting our hands in other people's pockets and other people's governments, and that is probably where we're going to come back to haunt us in some ways. You know, that's where all the immigrants are coming from because we messed things up down in Central America years ago, and so now.
Well, it goes all the way back to I think the Monroe Doctrine that we are supposed to get involved in foreign affairs now. Personally, I think we are one world. I don't think you can separate anymore. And, you know, if somebody, you know, throws their garbage in the ocean, and, you know, in the river upstream, it's going to float down to us.
Right. Exactly.
And we can know, you know, we're at a point now where if China doesn't stop burning coal, it doesn't matter what we do.
Of course not.
So, you know, obviously it's all connected and we have to be a leader. This is why the isolationism that this administration believes in, it's simply not going to work. I don't even want to get into the philosophy of it. It doesn't work anymore.
No, we are all members of the same planet, and it all belongs to us equally. That's the thing. That's why I never really understood the idea of real estate, but I have real estate, so I'm okay with it. But it's our planet. We all own it the same. It's the same for you as it is for me or anybody else down the street, anywhere in the world. It's we all breathe the same air. We drink the same water. So we are collective, yep. And that may be the shift that takes. Now, as a kid, when I was growing up, I always thought that the only way we're ever going to make the world a united place is if we have some sort of outside problem that forces us all to join together, which could either be alien intervention, it could be climate change. I personally believe it's going to be climate change. We're going to have to address this. We have to address this problem as a collective, as a body of people together. We can't do this apart.
But first you have to break the backs of those. Look,
yeah,
you
got to break the backs.
Right. I don't know if you read this, but all wine from California that have been tested, including organic wines, have Roundup in them.
Wow. Because they use it as a...
Think about that.
Yeah, I know. I understand that. Yep, I know.
A multi-billion dollar industry that supports thousands and thousands of people, and they allowed Monsanto, and they allowed this poison to seep. And the reason why it's in organic wines is because they take over land that has been used.
Yeah.
And they make it organic, but the poison is already in the ground.
It's heritage. Yeah, it's already there. They can't get rid of it. Yeah, it's got a long, long, long arm of reach on that one. That is a disgusting thing. See, that's why we need these organizations like the EPA. We need them. Of course, they're being dismantled too. So,
well, they're being dismantled because of this government.
I know that. I understand. So people have to wake up.
I know you know. I mean, yeah. You and I have always agreed to a large extent politically. We have our differences, of course, which is healthy. But certainly, it doesn't make any sense to me at all. I mean, I just don't understand. You know, you're rich and you want to stay rich. Well, then give enough to other people so they don't hit you over the head and take your wallet.
Yeah, and that's why I'm saying, that's why equality is such an important thing. That's why this is sort of like a summoning moment where the crescendo is building, the orchestra is getting ready to hit the big timpani drums, and the cymbals are going to go off, and it will be a boom moment of sorts, whereby we come to a term and we say, wow, we can't live like this any longer. And it will come. I think we're seeing all of the markers are in place now as we march towards these coming years. And it's kind of scary in a way, but I don't want to impose scare on people. I want people to be aware of it and turn to the other direction, lean into the problem, and let's resolve these problems while we can. I mean, that's the only way I can see to get out of it.
No, I agree. I don't think the fear, while fear and guilt are not useless commodities, if they'll make you change, I prefer to look at it in terms of a guarded optimism.
Yeah, I think that's that caution.
Just to get back to what the original conversation was, because you and I tend to veer off in many different directions, the markets are certainly heading into very scary times. In June, we will see what happens. It could go one of two ways, because the planet Uranus is going to hit Venus in the New York Stock Exchange's chart. Either we are going to see a severe dip, or maybe the Trump administration works something out with China, and temporarily everybody goes, oh my God, that's great, and they rally the markets 1,000 points, at which point I would be standing there with my finger on the button waiting to short it, because it will be a temporary rise.
Blip, yeah.
Because we are certainly heading into, look, all of the signs are there, Chris, not only the debt in America, but throughout the world. China's economy is slowing. Europe, Italy is already in a recession.
Mm-hmm.
Germany is having a terrible, terrible year. It's happening all over. Turkey, we already discussed briefly.
Britain doesn't know which way to go.
Well, Brexit is just, you know, again, it's the same mentality. We want it to be like it was in before the Second World War. Well, build yourself a time machine. Go have a good time.
You're not going to get back there. No kidding. I know. Pretty dire stuff. But I think that the way we should end this is say, you know, the best thing to do is, I always say, we are best prepared when we are best informed. If we are informed as to the possibility of this happening, the prospect of this on the road, down the road, we can prepare ourselves to weather the storm as successfully as possible. And I think that's what your overall message is at this, that there are going to be fluctuations. We are going to see these things happening. But if you can prepare yourself because you've got this foreknowledge, then you can ride out the storm.
Absolutely.
And that's the idea.
Absolutely.
So listen, we're going to try to do this on a more regular basis. I'm not sure yet. Mitch and I are going to talk about it. Folks out there, you are listening. We're going to talk about how to do this going forward. But we want to have a regular segment, a regular show that focuses on the finances of the time, because we are marching into this period of time where the more you have knowledge you have, the better off you'll be. So look
and
forward
to that.
And
if some of your listeners have questions or things that they'd like us to discuss,
yeah, let me know.
You know, by all means, let us know.
Yeah.
And we'll have our notes here, and we will talk directly to you. It's not a call-in show,
at least the ideas will be out there. The people's questions will be asked, and it's an important thing to do. It's a good way of communicating. Anyway, we're talking to Mitchell Scott Lewis today. Yeah, his website is jupiterrising.com or mitchastro.com. I encourage you to go there and look at his lectures. He's got a series of lectures that you can purchase, all of which deal with finances. And, he's a dynamic speaker.
No, they're also relationships and other things.
Oh, of course there are. But he's a dynamic speaker. He makes his points very clear, and it comes down to a very simple logic. And once you understand it, you really can benefit quite well from all these things. So I encourage you to do that. You can also go to chrisflisher.com or turningthewheel.com to find out my astrology works and stuff like that, and to find out what the podcasts are as well as all that. So keep in touch and see what happens to us. And if you have questions, write to Mitch, jupiterrising.com, mitchastro.com, and we'll try to address them when we come onto the show again next time. In the meantime, Mitch, thank you so much for coming on today. It's always great talking to you.
Thank you, Chris.
And
we
will touch base soon.
Very good.
Okay.
You've been listening to Turning of the Wheel with your host, Chris Flisher. To schedule a reading with me or to order artwork, you may visit my website at www.turningofthewheel.com. That's www.turningofthewheel.com. Or you can call me at 978-393-1036. Thank you. And as always, be open to possibilities.